three things that we're going to cover. The first is we're going to talk about some stuff related to that topic of targeted attacks. The second is we're going to show you some things related to that. And then we're also going to give you a chance to look at some of the stuff we're going to talk about, because you'll notice that the first thing we're going to talk about as a precursor to all of this is a little bit of an overview about the sort of work that we get involved in as malware analysts. And that's the bit that Ram's going to cover. I'm going to hand over to Ram to cover that bit now.
Okay. Thanks a lot, David. So the first thing I want to do is just run through some statistics for you. Now, every single day in our virus lab, we see about 70,000 new pieces of samples. Now, we probably sometimes get maybe 500,000 files every single day. One of those, we get the 70,000 number. So it's a huge undertaking. But most of those can't be done by humans, really. And we call our virus analysts woodpeckers. And in a moment, I'm going to get you to become woodpeckers. Because usually Kaspersky named them, because all day long they just peck at the keyboard. What we do now have is an automatic woodpecker, so it's all done through automated systems. So 90%, probably more than that actually, is done purely by automation. But we still have malware analysts that will look at the harder things that the automatic systems cannot detect. So, like I say, we've got automatic analysis there. We have multi-scanners, so we don't just rely on just kind of one engine. We can use kind of multiple engines to detect whether something's the virus. We've got web crawlers, we've got honeypots. Have you heard about honeypots? So basically, it's a system you set up, and maybe you've done it in university here, and basically you try to track all the malware or the spam to the system, and then we collect that information. And one thing I want to emphasize is the manual analyst part, and this is a bit I'm going to get you to help us on. And there's two types. There's the dynamic analysis, and this is where you throw the malware onto a live system, and then you run some tools and just to check what kind of changes it makes to the system. And then we have the static analysis part, and this is kind of the reverse engineering part of it. So you're starting the systems up, you're following the code basically, trying to find out what it's doing at the code level. So the dynamic analysis part, does anybody heard of sysinternals at all? So it's a really good tool. You can actually download it all as a suite of tools now, and it's got lots and lots of different types of tools. And what you generally would do is, before you run the malware on your system, is you set up some of these tools, and so you know exactly what files are running, what processes are running, and then you run the malware and you see what changes it makes. So some of the ones that we use is Process Explorer, FileMon, RegMon, because then it tells you whether it's creating keys in the registry, if it's making other changes to the system. And then from that we can work out what it's doing. I'm guessing some of you have heard of like Wireshark, and you've probably seen on the systems out here that you use Wireshark on here. So you're looking at the traffic, what's going on. One that we use quite often as well is a small HTTP server, because a lot of times, for example, Trojan downloaders, what they would do, they'll go off to a website and download the malware. So what we can do is use the small HTTP server to mimic that. So it's not actually going anywhere, but the malware thinks it's going somewhere and downloading something, so we can actually trace the activity that it's doing. So the static analysis, has anybody used IDA Pro at all? Or here? It's really useful. There's a free version which you can download, and there's a paid for version. And essentially, we've got some really clever people who can look at these code and they can tell whether something's malware or not. After 6 months or to a year, our experienced virus analysts, they can actually just use these, and they can work out what malware typically does. But essentially what they're doing, they're following the code from jump. Jump from one place to another and see what it's doing at the static level. So that's using, so essentially what it's doing, trying to follow the code. So URL download to file, shell execute. So it's kind of, you can work out that that's actually trying to go and look for a file on the internet and try to download it and execute it. So, and a lot of times what I tend to do, because I don't know what the processes are or the functions do, this is where I Google it or Bing it, or you can use the Microsoft Developer Network. So I use Google a lot in the support and trying to find files, so you can't know every single function.
Start by looking at how disks get addressed. You know, the cylinder or track number is first, head or side, sectors, and so typically any physical location on the disk is referenced by, let's say, cylinder 0, head 0, sector 1, which is the master boot record or the partition sector, or you could say 011, which is the boot sector on the machine. So we don't have to worry about that. When we use a computer, that's all handled by the operating system. If we can look at it two-dimensionally and get a conception of how the computer starts up. Once the BIOS has loaded the initial instructions it needs to get the computer up and running, the first thing on the disk that gets executed is actually code in the master boot record. That's the first sector on the disk that's executed. And there's two parts to the NBR. The first bit is executed with code. Its job effectively is to do one of two things. One is to decode the partition table, which says how the machine is partitioned and where the bootable partition is. And the second bit is, if it can't do that and there's a serious error, to display a message telling you that there's a serious error. Assuming everything goes okay, then the system files get executed and the boot sector gets executed, and then the operating system is up and running. So the MBR and the period between the MBR and the boot sector is typically just slack space, free space. So if we look at the normal boot sequence, you load the code in the MBR, it locates the boot sector and the operating system loads up. But actually, literally, what you find on the computer is you have the MBR. And then typically, I mean, on that machine, it's going to be something in the order of 60-odd sectors, which are completely blank. Now, in the old days, when we first started to see PC viruses, the most common type of infection was a boot sector virus. Standard way of infecting was to dump your code on the MBR, take a copy of the original and relocate it, so that when the BIOS loads, it passes control to the virus goes into memory, it then passes control to the MBR, the system loads as normal, but what you're left in memory is the virus. Well, modern malware isn't interested in infecting floppy disks, which is what those boot sector viruses were designed to do. But the reason for infecting at that level, and why a bootkit does it, is really to get control as early on in the boot sequence as possible. Because if you're loading before the operating system, you get to play first. You get to hold on to control. So it piggybacks a network driver or piggybacks some other system driver that's loaded up, so that it's actually in resident in memory first, and by doing so is able to then manipulate the system to evade control. So Cinewell, which is one of the boot kits which Ram referred to there, it's actually, its function is a backdoor Trojan. And the backdoor Trojan, it could be used to connect up to a bot, it could be used for ID theft, for launching a denial of service attack, it could be used for gathering information, it could be used for distributing spam, all kinds of purposes. What the bootkit part of it is designed to do is to provide a malware invisibility cloak to protect it. So apologies about the demo, that's my fault, I take responsibility for that. Let's crack on and start to sort of paint a picture then of the threat landscape and get into the targeted attacks part of this. We've got some numbers here. Now the interesting thing here is this is focused on signatures. Signatures basically are sequences of bytes which we use to identify malware. And you can see that right now it's up to just under 6 million. 6 million signatures is all. And I say is all, that's a huge number, but actually it's way, way, way below the number of samples. Right now in the lab we get every day about 70,000 unique samples. We build each day about 3,500 signatures. So you can work out from that that actually the ratio of signature to samples is one to many, sometimes one to hundreds. The other thing is that they're not all detected using signatures. We've got a range of other technologies, some of which actually we refer back to. Signatures are only part of it. We've got generic code for detecting multiple signatures. We have heuristic signatures looking not at sequences of bytes, but actually at characteristic parts of the code. We analyze behavior in real time. We emulate the instructions in the code pre-execution. We use sandboxing techniques as well. A whole range of different things, whitelisting as well as blacklisting technologies. So we actually combine a whole range of technologies, many of them proactive. And in fact, signatures now represent a diminishing part of the techniques we use for detecting stuff on an individual computer or an endpoint within a corporation. So that underestimates it, but actually you can see, at least from this, the sort of the rise in terms of volume. At least the curve is telling you at what rate we're seeing new malware coming at us. And actually that's one of the reasons why over the last 5, 6, 7 years, the relative weight of proactive technologies has had to increase, because otherwise there's no way you could cope with the numbers if you weren't doing something other than just signature checking. I've taken a snippet here from something on our website called Virus Watch, which kind of looks real time at what gets analysed. And I want to draw out some of what I've said already about numbers. You will see that, you know, alongside the identifying of what type of threat, what platform it is, by the way, Win32 is about 85% of what we see. Unique name, then we have this suffix, and the suffix identifies the variant number. And you'll gather from that we start at A, B, C, D, E, F, G. If we get to Z, then we do AA, AB, AC, BA, BB, BC. Well, you can do the maths on that, 26 by 26 by whatever, but actually for the first time when I took this snapshot, I do it fairly regularly, I've got one third down there, which is 5 particular characters. So ultimately, if that was Z, 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 that would be 26 by 26 by 26 by 26 by 26. Well, my sums work out that comes approximately to 12 million, which is a huge amount. It's not surprising, I mean, it's not listed there, but if you take what we call ZBot, Zeus Banking Trojan, there are literally tens of thousands of variants just of that one banking trojan. Tens of thousands. So many of that big number are actually variants. And one of the reasons for that is because the shelf life of any given variant could actually be really, really small. Back in the 90s, one threat, let's take Cascade, let's take Natas, let's take even something like Melissa at the sort of turn of the millennium, it would get out there and maybe stay out there for months, or in the case of Stone or Cascade, for years. So the shelf life once it was out there was long. So these guys didn't necessarily need to generate hundreds or thousands of variants. Now they do, because one variant of the Zeus banking trojan might last a week. And it lasts a week because we've got better in terms of proactive detection. But even when you're using signatures, the chances are that you get detection out there a lot quicker. And therefore, in order to maintain control over a computer that has been compromised, it's necessary to download a new variant. And Graham's already alluded to Trojan downloaders. They're the updaters of malware. And typically a malware infection will be a compound structure. You'll have a downloader, maybe worm functionality, maybe also a backdoor built in with a keylogger. And so they're composite structures, and the downloader part of it is really just to keep it fresh and undetected as long as possible. So top 10 threats on the internet, well, you get an idea here that many of them are Trojans, actually. But you do get sort of generic things like malicious URL, and that's a generic detection based on what we find on a website. So our web antivirus component would say, you know, we're going to block that because it looks suspicious. Iframer, again, a generic detector for anything which has a suspicious iframe built into the HTML, and so on. Detected on computers, and this is different. This is detected from the web, stuff accessing the web specifically. This is anything. It could come from a USB key. It could come from a CD. It could come across the network. So these are things which are getting onto the computer in general, not just via the web. And there's more than just Trojans here. We do get viruses in the world. But even so, Trojans represent the biggest chunk of what we see. So how does malware get into a system? And we can divide it really into two, from the outside and from the inside. From the inside, of course, across the network, USB, CD. From the outside, actually, perhaps 80% of what we see these days is web-based. So that's a huge aspect of it. But email and other stuff continues to be important. But notice here, in either case, social engineering, people being tricked into doing something they shouldn't, is a huge aspect of security in business, in any sort of organisation really, and also for individual people at home. Drive-by downloads. This is the term used really to indicate that somebody's just an innocent passerby visiting a web page and they get infected automatically. They didn't do anything. Not quite. They didn't patch something on the computer, is what they didn't do. And the malware on the website is manipulating a vulnerability on the system in order to infect, in order to download code and run it. People don't necessarily care about patches. Actually, with Windows and automatic updates, it's pretty easy for people. It's not quite so easy for businesses, because at the end of the day, if at home my computer doesn't get patched, that's bad news perhaps for me, but its impact on other people is pretty small. In a business, the impact could be wider, but on the other hand, if I apply a patch and it disrupts an otherwise working system, I don't look like the hero who just saved the day from the next infection. I look like the idiot who destabilized the network. So in corporations, they've got a real difficult decision about which ones do we patch, how quickly do we roll it out, can we do any local environment testing, and so on. So no web page can be trusted, because actually these drive-by downloads are a bit like a cuckoo in the nest. They take a legitimate website, one which the password for it, the admin password, didn't get changed. It's default. So these guys can use the internet. They perhaps know from the patchy server what the default admin password might be in a given case, and they just try them. Or they will look for badly prepped databases, SQL servers, and try to make use of SQL exploits. Or they will look for other aspects of the operating system or the software on them which haven't been hardened in some way. Or they simply look for unpatched resources. And quite often, and something mentioned earlier, the idea of polymorphism, which is changing the code each infection to vary it. So you can't just have a simple signature. You've got to do some other stuff as well, some statistical analysis, some emulation. Quite often, obfuscation techniques are used to try and prevent analysis. And you start out looking at a website which looks something like this, and it's not much really readable. Well, there is in individual characters, but not in terms of code. And you decrypt, and you start to get stuff. You think, yeah, okay, there's a document right there, a bit more which is understandable. And then you go through more levels of encryption, and you suddenly find out, okay, there's an iframe there, and you look at where that's going, and you look at how big it is on the page, and so on. Maybe you find out it's height zero, width zero, so they're trying to conceal stuff. But actually, this sort of operation can happen hourly. So they design it, so they recompile their script every hour, and each time they recompile it, they put some variable instructions in, which don't affect the operation of the malware, but do mean that you can't just expect to find the same thing in the same place every time you look at it, which means we really have to have some more generic ways of looking at this, and multiple downloads and all kinds of stuff to try and see through this, sort of the layers of encryption. Social networks are one form of infection, and they're on the rise, and they're on the rise because social networks themselves are on the rise. Criminals are like pickpockets, they follow the crowds, and people are, you know, Facebook's huge. It's bigger than most countries in the world if you look at the number of people using it in any given day. So it doesn't have to be, it could be LinkedIn, it could be Twitter, it could be anything. And just like the standard way of trying to trick people, say 5-10 years ago, was to structure an email to try and coax people into clicking on an attachment, now you're much more likely to see a link in a Facebook message of an account which has been hacked and taken over. Because I'm going to click on something that a friend sends me, rather than a random piece of spam. So they've just moved the goalposts slightly, but the same techniques of trying to trick people. And, you know, it's not just social networks, but I mean, it's luring people with, you know, celebrity gossip. It's luring people with porn. It's luring people with, you know, interesting, catchy messages about what their friends are doing. Any of that will work. And what they load off the back of it could be malware, because they're using social networks to do several things. One is, as a way of spreading malware, so you spread links, people click on the links, you need some new codec to look at this video, but you don't really, actually what gets downloaded is a piece of fake antivirus, or some other piece of malware. But they're not just using it to spread malware, they're looking to gather data as well, and I'll come on to that more in a bit. Email. I don't want to give you the mistaken idea that email doesn't get used, because it does. It still continues to be a successful way of getting a foothold in an organization, sneaking the malware in as its first base, if you like. Spoofed email addresses are common. And here's one of the things that ties back to what I just said about social networks. If somebody wants to target my organization, one of the things that'd be useful to know is, what's the standard domain name? How do we structure our emails? It's Kaspersky.com. And if they know I'm David M. at Kaspersky.com, then they can start to send emails to me, personally. Spoofed, let's say, to look like it's come from the admin of my company, which makes it more likely that I'm going to click on the link, which takes me to a page which has our logo on it and asks me to type in our network, on my network login. But, you know, there are other mechanisms as well. Another example I'll touch on later, Stuxnet, which you've probably heard of. Highly targeted, sort of pushing the envelope in terms of malware technology. But actually you think, well, how do you get into a SCADA system if that SCADA system, supervisory control and data acquisition system, looking after sort of control, production and control systems of one sort or another, energy, power, car production, whatever, there's loads of them around. How do you get in if it's closed off from the internet? Well, USB drive is one of them. Somebody at home gets infected, puts the USB key in their pocket, goes into work, wants to transfer some data, infection. I talked about rootkits. Rootkits are just malware invisibility, folks. You don't see the file on the disk, not because it's hidden, as in our example, but actually because you know, somebody has camouflaged it, in other words, at lower level than just making it read-only or hidden. You don't see the process running in Task Manager. You don't see other types of activity on the network. They maybe, you know, take other precautions to try and prevent this. Make it as difficult to see installed files, stuff running, processes running as possible, because the longer the malware operates, the more it can do. And it's not the 1990s where people want to take down my computer. We're in an era, really, where my uptime is actually the business uptime of a cyber criminal. MBR infections, boot kits are just the latest in a long line of this. And there's not just one, there's a whole bunch of these. And in fact, 64-bit boot kits as well are growing in number now because more and more of us are using 64-bit systems, of course. Digital signing. If something has a signature, a digital signature, we tend to trust it. You know, it's been signed by a legitimate certificate authority, and it gets trusted. Not only by individuals, but security companies as well may trust it and put it on their whitelist of stuff that doesn't need to be scanned. The problem is, if a cybercriminal steals the certificate and generates their own, signs their malware, that's happening increasingly. It's happening on mobile devices, by the way, as well as on desktops. But again, Stuxnet used this mechanism. And this has been growing to the point at which, actually, certificate authorities can go out of business if they slip up with security and allow people to hack them and steal what's necessary for them to generate these certificates. DigiNotar, as an example, a Dutch CA. Its business didn't survive. Pretty much Nordic HP Gary, by the way, going back to my last example with the stolen credentials. Now, I've talked a little bit about targeted attacks, and just to give some wider context to this, we've got what we call spyware 2.0. It's not just a question of spreading code, it's a question of gathering information. So, yes, we're seeing very technically sophisticated malware, bootkits, 64-bit bootkits, we're seeing botnets which are using encryption, botnets which are using peer-to-peer mechanisms in order that there's not one controlling command server controlling the whole thing, because if there's one, you can take it down if you find out where it is. So all of that's true, but increasingly we're finding not malware aimed at you and me and everybody else, in the hope that one of us will do something silly and then they get access to our bank account, but also they're looking at this company. This company specifically. So slightly different aims to the speculative attack. That stuff's going on. People will still want my bank account and your bank account, but layered on top of it and growing in volume are the number of targeted attacks. And steal everything fits into this, because the information that we all share in social networks and elsewhere can be used to profile the people we work for. So we have two seemingly paradoxical trends. One is specific threats, and the other is steal everything. They're stealing widely, but using selectively. So they're quite happy to go through log files, they're quite happy to look at bitmap images, they're quite happy to look at configuration files, really anything they can trawl from somebody's computer or their social network account. And they'll aggregate it as well, they're quite happy to do that. So it might be that they get some information from me from LinkedIn, maybe my Facebook page, or blog, maybe information I'm sharing through Google+, maybe what I post on Twitter. I'll give you a concrete example because it helps to kind of make it real. Imagine that our company standardizes on Application X, and I hate Application X, or I hate the latest version of it, because compared to the previous one, I can't find things, I don't know how it operates, and so I get frustrated with that, and I'm on Twitter and I'm having a moan about it. I'm complaining and saying, oh, has anyone checked out the latest version of Application X? Isn't it horrendous? Perfectly innocent. You know, it's hard to see why the HR department would carpet me for that. But actually, without knowing it, I could well have told somebody who wants to target my company which application to go after. Because instead of looking at 50 possible vulnerable applications that might work, they now know we use that one. If they can find or buy an exploit for that application and a vulnerability in it, they're in business. They also know my name. They know it's Kaspersky.com. Maybe they also know a little bit more about the company. They know, you know, that we're structured with a headquarters in Moscow, and we've got satellite offices, and we've got regional headquarters. And they use all of this to compose some sort of phishing email. And once they're in, they've used that as a bridgehead to spread further. And if you look back a couple of years at Conficker, or what we call Kido, which rampaged through a lot of businesses, not many consumers got hit by that, but lots of businesses did. One of the ways in which it spread actually was by finding resources on the network that held passwords, or sorry, held network accounts, and trying to brute force those accounts. And it was incredible. I mean, we went into more than one organization and found that their password policy was woeful in terms of, you know, what they were requiring people to do. Sometimes it was just words. They weren't requiring people to use a mix of letters, symbols, and numbers. They weren't doing anything about it. So it was really easy to brute force some of these organizations.
And passwords and servers as well.
Exactly, yeah. No password, even worse. Or password, and it happens, even in corporations, it happens. People do use password as their password. It's not dumb users, this can be at a level above ordinary employees. I hate that term, dumb users, anyway. I mean, why would we expect individuals to be security experts? So, targeted attacks. I'm not going to go through every little bit of this, but broadly speaking, speculative attacks will spread far and wide. That's why they like worms, that's why they like viruses, that's why they will post something on a website, that's why they'll camouflage it as sex or free audio or video content. Targeting attacks, they don't spread very far because they're going for one organization or one type of organization. Which means we may not get a sample, by the way, of that. That's another point I'll come back to. Step one, if you're going to launch a targeted attack, is reconnaissance. Find out as much as you can about the organization. Find out about the individuals in there, the structure, the systems, the software being used. Step two, prepare an attack. Find out if there's a vulnerability for application X. If there is, create some exploit code to use it, or buy an exploit kit that includes that particular application. And use that as your way in, coupled with some social engineering tricks to make people click on a link, click on an attachment. Step three, access, and that's really escalate your level of access. So try to get to a point, ideally, if you can, where you've compromised an admin computer and you get to piggyback somebody else's access to the network. Encryption is great. Encryption is great on an endpoint, it's great for the company as a whole, but actually malware writers, cyber criminals use it as well. And cyber criminals use it because, well, two things. One is, people like us are generally, or companies generally, organizations generally, are looking outwards at stuff coming in. But once somebody's got into an organization, they're not necessarily filtering or trying to sniff traffic from the inside out. And if it's encrypted, it's pretty difficult to do anyway. So they're using encryption to communication between the control and command server and each individual compromised endpoint. Step four is get the interesting stuff out. But before they get it out, they typically tend to fold it all together into a drop zone within the organization. And the reason for doing that is traffic within the organization is less likely to be noticed as suspicious than someone leaving wholesale. So they will tend to gather it in one or more drop zones and then get it out. If they do that last bit in one operation, it may well be too late for them, even if the company realizes they're under attack. Well, a great picture of the Aurora Borealis. Where does that come in? Well, going back a couple of years, that's the name that was given to an exploit that was used to target a bunch of companies, among them Google. Google actually, to their credit, came out and said, you know, we're under attack here. We think it's the Chinese, but, you know, there's no smoking gun here. They published this on the 12th of January. Microsoft patched the vulnerability being used about a week later. Now, actually, that vulnerability could have been usable for the cyber criminals for way more than a week. That's a week between it being realized that it was there and it being patched. But what if the cyber criminals knew that existed before the good guys did? That's what we call a zero-day vulnerability. One which exists and no knowledge of it exists from the vendor whose application it is. Actually, an hour is quite enough, but sometimes you will find that there are even things which have been patch has been available for months and they're still successful. Stuxnet, another example. Stuxnet was targeting SCADA systems, these supervisory control and data acquisition systems. It used a rootkit, digital signature. It made use of 5 vulnerabilities in total. Now it's pretty, you know, it's not routine for 1 zero-day vulnerability to be used. Vulnerabilities are very common, their use is very common, but it's still relatively uncommon for a zero-day to be used. This thing used 4 zero-day vulnerabilities. Too far. The organization, the intelligence needed, the knowledge of the systems needed by this thing, make us pretty convinced that this was required the resources over and above the level of the criminal gangs we see routinely doing banking trojans or denial of service attacks or other types of attacks on systems. This was also very, very focused. It was a worm, so it spread. We think that may even have been designed that way to slightly camouflage what the specific target was. Security researchers generally around the globe believe that this was specifically designed to target Iran's nuclear power facility in their hands. There's plenty of evidence of that. So in this case, you know, there is a smoking gun, but we don't know necessarily who was holding that gun. People can infer it, I'm not going to though. So that's Stuxnet. Things have moved on even from Stuxnet. If you've heard of Dooku, we discovered Dooku after Stuxnet, but actually it looks like Dooku is actually an underlying platform used for the development of Stuxnet, and we found a second variant of Dooku. So it may well be actually that the sort of the platform, the framework for developing it, has been used for other things. Dooku we heard about 6 months ago, but we know from looking at some of the modules that belong to it that it goes back perhaps as far as 2007. So with a targeted attack, because lots of people don't get hit by it, we don't necessarily get a sample, the only way we can find it is if somebody is using software that has proactive capabilities in it. Or if something happens in a particular vertical market, and then somebody realizes that there's an issue. So Dooku was designed to collect information. Stuxnet was designed to sabotage a system. Specifically sabotage a system. And this kind of attack, I mean, I'm not suggesting that there are going to be loads of Stuxnets and Dookus. That's right at the far edge. But certainly the number of targeted attacks has gone up to that. I touched on HB Gary as an example, so I'm not going to go into that. These guys, I mean, can you arrest them? Because how do you know? How do you know who they are? It's a bit like trying to round up the Freemasons. You don't know who's a Freemason, who isn't. So it's a very loose group rather than a sort of a closely affiliated network as such. Same with LulzSec. But they use the V for Vendetta symbol all over the place, and they sort of hide behind this sort of woolly, loose affiliation. But you know, HB Gary isn't their only attack or victim. So, I mentioned about HB Gary and what happened there, so you know, I don't need to go into too much detail, but the CEO got compromised. He used a variety of different techniques, but what I want to get to is 50,000 confidential emails leaked, massive public relations problem, CEO resigned, big implications for that company. It's now been taken over. You could argue that perhaps that's one of the reasons, because its credibility as a security organisation was hugely diminished. But there's others as well. Take LulzSec and the different organisations it's gone after. And you know, the list goes on and on. You've got the Sony PlayStation hack, you've got RSA, you've actually got attacks on others like Lockheed Martin. How did you get at Lockheed Martin? You get at Lockheed Martin because Lockheed Martin used RSA tokens. The guys that attacked RSA got the algorithm for generating the numbers on the RSA token. so they could compromise anyone using it. So there's a domino effect potentially on this targeted attack too. And is it little wonder really with all of this that governments are looking at this and saying, you know what, if systems like Stony PlayStation or HB Gary or RSA or Google are vulnerable, you know, we use computers just like any other organisation. We need to make sure, you know, we're bulletproof in some way. Okay, click on through some of the graphics here. Dooku, I sort of mentioned here. I mean, it was clearly designed to do spying exercises. We believe it was on Iran's nuclear stuff. But look, it serves all over the place, including in Europe. And that isn't just something peculiar to Dooku. It's also used by other, if you like, run-of-the-mill cybercrime botnets, that they use this distributed approach, that they have a peer-to-peer model where you've got multiple CNC servers rather than just one. It's really hard to take them down. It can be done with techniques like sinkholing, where effectively you gather control of all of the compromised computers so they're connected to you. We've been involved in exercises like that. Microsoft has been involved in exercises like that, and you end up with a botnet that's pretty much neutralized until somebody creates a variant, and then new botnets can come into its place. So you think, well, SCADA systems, how on earth do people get into a system that's closed? Now, I've hinted at it, you know, with the USB key, but there are other aspects to this. One is, take our organization. We necessarily are outward facing. We want customers coming to us to buy from us, apart from anything else, but we've got huge, lots of information we're feeding out. But if you are running a nuclear plant, for example, you don't want to be open to a wider network. But what that means as a byproduct is that you probably don't patch your systems. And I went to a talk recently at a security conference where there were some guys looking at this, and they'd done all sorts of research. But they were finding out that there were some systems in some SCADA setups which were still running Windows 98 or Windows Server 2000. Because the idea was, well, how do you patch it? Because to patch it, you've got to open it up to the internet. And the problem with that is, great, you have a walled garden and you're behind it and you're not patching and you're not allowing people to connect. But if somebody gets over that wall, it's easy because you're running a system which hasn't got up-to-date patches for it. And that's actually a problem. You know, it's a USB key infection, once it gets in there, can actually run them off. Actually, at the same presentation, or the same conference, some other presenters were talking about some US-based SCADA systems, and there were some horror stories. They were talking about prison systems, where they were finding that sort of prison warders were actually surfing the net on the same systems that were being used to control the entry points for the prison. It's a bit scary, really, if you think about it. But, you know, segmentation of networks is great, and everybody knows the theory, and you've seen the policy, but in practice, people cut corners, whether it's passwords, dumb users using the same passwords for multiple accounts, or whether it's system administrators. So, okay, vectors and consequences. The threats, obviously, you know, we're talking about denial of service attacks, maybe, sure. We're talking about TCP, IP, FTP, UDP as a protocol. We're talking about gaining control of the system, sabotage, possibly. We're talking about spying for commercial reasons or other reasons. But ultimately, potentially, you've got a threat to life and limb, possibly, because if you're applying the same sorts of technologies at a hospital or the same sort of technology as a water-based system, the consequences could be hugely more impactful than perhaps delaying Iran's nuclear program. And this is not pie in the sky. You can sort of look back. I'm not going to go through each of these. And by the way, we can get the slides. We'll get the slides to you for this. But you can look back at stuff which is affecting real production systems. And you know, you don't have to go to water production plants or power plants. Look at Sony PlayStation Network and consider that. Tens of thousands of emails taken, addresses taken, dates of birth, names taken. Now, do you think everybody who was using the Sony PlayStation Network following that hack last year has changed their password? Probably not. And do you think a proportion goes, I've got the same password for their bank? Probably. So it could be quite mundane as well as, you know, big, impactful stories like this, you know, five multinational oil and gas companies suffered computer network intrusions or, you know, whatever it is. So in terms of business security and looking at how businesses or any organisation sort of mitigates this, you've got to look at comprehensive protection, because if it's signature-based alone, there's no hope of keeping up the volume, keeping up the level of sophistication. So yes, we're talking about application control, whitelisting technologies, we're talking about filtering at the web level, we're talking about anti-spam, since that's the source of these links or attachments. Manageability is huge as well. It's only useful, software is only useful if you can realistically use it. Virtualization support, because there's a massive growth, a massive development towards storing stuff in the cloud. There's a massive growth in business towards using virtualized systems. Not just in business, of course, these are virtualized systems. Sadly, some people think that security comes built in. It doesn't. You've got to plan it in the same way that you would for any system, physical system. And the cloud doesn't remove the need for security. It actually adds another layer of potential insecurity, because actually you've got a massive safe full of goodies in the cloud, which is a one-stop shop if you can get access to it for lots of people's data. You get Amazon, and you don't just get Amazon's information, you get lots of customers' information as well. But there is a human dimension to this as well. Policy in general, risk assessment, network segmentation, all of that stuff, but the human factor is huge. All those targeted attacks, nearly always the initial foothold was a human being taken in. And yet actually, going around companies, it doesn't always get the attention that it needs. And when it does, one of the dangers is that people like us in an organisation, us and you by the way, get asked to frame policy documents that employees, that staff are meant to sign up to. But the problem is that techies are great with technology. They're not necessarily the people who are skilled professionally at getting information out to people. And what I think few companies do is enlist their marketing teams, in their legal teams, their HR teams, in communicating with individuals. And we need to, because you can't change behaviour overnight. You've got to chip away at it, but it does work. When I was young, and it is a long time ago, it wasn't that common for people to wear seatbelts in cars. Now, there still are people who don't wear seatbelts in cars, but actually, it's standard now. When I was a kid as well, drink driving really wasn't considered to be a huge deal. Now, if somebody's convicted of drink driving, few people have sympathy if they've caused an accident or, you know, in worst cases, killed somebody. And rightly so. But actually, going back 40 years, 50 years, it didn't cause that much of a stir. So it takes time, and I think actually one of the issues of why there isn't a sort of online common sense is because still this is new technology. In generational terms, it's new technology. And the people who you would expect to have the knowledge to pass on common sense to children are not yet parents in many cases. And the people who are parents of my generation, they might have, be able to teach their kids about not taking sweets from strangers, but they don't necessarily know about the dangers of social networks and giving out information and so on. Okay, so a summary of the major trends that we've seen. And on the left, you've kind of got the technology type stuff, if you like, boot kits, cross-platform attacks. I haven't really talked about mobile threats, but I mean, the biggest attack vector on mobiles is Android, actually. But until 6 months ago, that wasn't the case. Most malware until 6 months ago was Java-based, because it's cross-platform. You can get Android, you can get Symbian, you know, could go for any number of smartphones. They all support Java, mostly. Steal everything, and yet targeted attacks, selective use of the data, cryptography, stealing of certificates, encrypted communication in botnets. You know, you look at some of the trends we're seeing. Yes, sophistication, diversification. I mean, 3 years ago, gaming malware. Malware designed to steal login credentials for games was huge because there was a market for it. It's tailed off a bit. Fake antivirus. It's tailed off a little bit now. It's on a downward trend. But these guys are no different to any other type of business. This is just the underbelly of the legitimate world. And capital always flows from one area to a more productive area if it can, and it's no different for the dark market. So if something isn't producing a return on investment, they'll go elsewhere. They will aggregate the data. Yes, we're seeing cyber espionage growing as a trend, absolutely. Cyber war, I hate the term. It's an interesting discussion point. When does something become a war? A discussion yesterday with somebody, like, well, is it when the victim says, we've been the victim of an attack, of a form of aggression. Do you have to have a conventional war in order for there to be a war? If somebody takes out power plants in an organization, is that an act of war? Is it an act of terrorism? Is it a cyber attack? Does it depend on the motives of the attacker? There's all sorts of things wrapped up in that, which I don't want to get to. I'm right now fairly uncomfortable with the term war, but you know, on the other hand, if somebody is taking out a nuclear facility, then you've got to say, well, actually, we're getting mighty close to that sort of area. And again, going back to what I said, little wonder that governments have a vested interest in it because they use computers too. So trends, what are we seeing? Well, spyware 2.0 yet continues. Peer-to-peer technologies, either to spread code or actually to spread the load of a botnet, that's increasing. 64-bit attacks increasing as we all use it more. Smartphones, I mean, we're now up to, what's about 9,000 signatures, but signatures really understates it because actually a piece of malware can appear in many, many guises, including in the Android marketplace, for example, as well as just out there on sites that people might or might not go to. So it's growing, and the reason it's growing is because it's doing more things on them. You can bank now, you can move money around with a smartphone, you can buy things, and where there's the ability to access money, meaning my smartphone, there's an interest for somebody else to intercept that, to gain access to the same facility. Bank accounts, that'll continue. Just like, you know, we might see sophisticated attacks on banks or other organisations in the physical world, but we still get pickpockets on the tube. Well, the same thing's going to, you know, they'll still be the people who allow their password to be easily guessed and gain access to bank accounts. That will continue. Targeted attacks on the increase. We're not talking about that. That's not the main thrust of malware. But it is growing in relative terms. What's down? Well, gaming malware, attacks through email. It's not that they've gone. But in relative terms, in terms of the numbers, the weighting, email attachments is no longer the main way of spreading code. It's still there, but it's falling compared to links and compared to social network-based attacks. So this is going to be the second part of my demo, but moving on, let's just flick through that. We wanted to cover also something about the perils of social networks in a bit more detail and perhaps give some pointers about safe use of it. You can ask yourself the question, which social media do you use? You know, it may well be that it's Twitter, Facebook, Google+, LinkedIn maybe. There's a whole range of stuff out there, you know, from sharing photos to anything really. If you want to do it, you pretty much can. They're social networks. The whole purpose of them is it brings people together. People make friends, keep friends, maintain friendships, buy and sell, all kinds of things. But the point about Web 2.0 is that it's interactive. It the old days, you bought something from a website. You retrieved some information from a website. Now it's a participatory sport. You engage in it. You share stuff as much as some of the numbers show. One of the problems, though, is that people don't necessarily realize the potential dangers of doing it. And these guys work with crowds. So we've seen malware spread through social networks. We've seen phishing attacks. We've seen CNC servers, Twitter being used to coordinate botnets. We've seen links, exposure of personal data, client vulnerabilities. It's all out there and being used. Malvertising, clickjacking, where you effectively secrete something under a legitimate display on a web page so that somebody clicks on something, but they're not clicking on something, they're clicking on something bad. Examples. I mentioned one earlier. Just something juicy which people want to share on Facebook with a link. And it's a shortened URL, notice. So you don't see where it's going to because it's a shortened URL. This happens on Twitter, of course. And the reason is because you've got that 140 character limit. But you can't see that that's going to, you know, joescybercrimeworkshop.com. See who's viewing your Facebook profile. Yeah, I want to do that. Applications and giving them permissions to post to your wall, giving them permissions that you may not even realise that it's doing it. Because here, security kind of starts to blur over into privacy, and the two get merged. Porn always works. Offline, online. It works. With at least 50% of the population, it works. Botnets, as I mentioned, being coordinated through Twitter. Your LinkedIn account was blocked due to inactivity. Click here to reactivate it. Well, I know not to. You probably know not to, but there's lots of people out there who don't realise it. It made me panic a little bit. Yeah, better do that. You can't train people to be security aware. You can train somebody to use a word processor or a database, because at the end of the day, you can produce a guide and they can go through the steps. The problem with social engineering is it's always some new trick that people are using. So what you really have to try and do is develop a sort of general awareness, a mindset. Suspicion. We all have it in the offline world. Somebody knocks on the door and wants to come in. A bit suspicious about it, but we're not the same when it comes to online stuff. But informed paranoia would be what I would recommend. With privacy, it's really important. Actually, sometimes the most private thing on a social network is the privacy policy. Because they don't necessarily want you to see the privacy policy. Think about Facebook. Facebook recently applied for, or registered for IPO, initial public offering, and they had to value the company. What's the value? Anyone know? Facebook account, yeah, everybody's got a Facebook account. Did you pay for it? So where's the model? Where are they getting the money from? Data, advertising. And it's the same for Google. It's a little wonder that Google changed the privacy policy so that the settings apply across it. The information will be shared across all Google accounts. So look at security now. The first thing I would say is think about what you're accessing. And I'm thinking here about HTTPS. Because not all social networks default to that. If you've got HTTPS, click somewhere on there. It's different for different browsers. This is Chrome. But you've got a certificate. It doesn't mean that the information couldn't possibly be sniffed, but it does reduce the risk. And I won't go to somewhere where I'm going to share details if it's not HTTPS. And by the way, that goes for anything they expect us to use internally as well. HTTPS, right off the bat. And, you know, transfer this to the mobile world, where people are using smartphones in business, on the road, at the airport, using somebody else's wireless connection. If you're not using HTTPS, again, you're even more wide open. So how are you accessing it? Think about passwords. Complex passwords, not words that are in the dictionary. Numbers, letters, symbols. Different ones for every account. Use a password manager. If you can't remember them all, you can use a password manager program to hold them for you. Auto-generate it for you. use a passphrase. You don't want to hear that. Think of a passphrase. You never think of them at times like this. The old typist one. The quick brown fox jumps over the lazy dog. It uses every letter on the keyboard, English keyboard. So you take your passphrases, T, Q, B, F, and so on. That's my passphrase. Now, log into Amazon. I have a rule. So what I do is I take the A for Amazon and put it at the beginning. Second step of my rule is semicolon after the third character. Fourth rule, use a non-alphanumeric character after the fifth one. Now, you end up there, you take the same Twitter and what have you. So with a passphrase and a four-step rule, you have a unique password, but not too much to remember. Where are you accessing it from? So is your environment secure? Is it a corporate network? Are you using a VPN? If not, so if I'm at the airport, use the VPN token. Are you at home? Is your router configured? Did you change the default password? Is it broadcasting? Or have you disabled the SSID? All of that stuff. How is your router configured? BDU filters, not so much important maybe for you, but for business it is. The number of times I've been on planes, or elsewhere, trains actually as well, and you're sitting behind somebody, and if you really took an interest in what their business was, you could find out all kinds of information. But the VDU filter you can't, because it's only the person right in front of it that gets to see it. Is it a public resource? A colleague took this picture at an airport, somebody logged into Facebook, didn't log out again. It happens. Or they didn't clear the cache. If somebody wants to dig a bit further, even if you've logged out, it might be stuck in the cache. So, think about how much it could be worth. And, you know, you think about passwords being used across different sites. That if somebody knows who you are, where you live, date of birth, credit card number, bank account number, what could they do? So, think about the information that you put out there, basically. And disaster stories. Twitter. If you're using social media, think about it. You know, especially after you leave uni and you start working, it's really important. White people love playing divide and rule. She didn't mean anything by it, but it caused a heck of a furor in the press that she's making some racist statement. Charlie Sheen, 310-954-7277, call me bro, see. Charlie Sheen posted that. It was meant to be a direct post to Justin Bieber. He posted it to all his followers. Sad to hear that Bob Holness has died. A generation will remember him fondly from Blackbusters. Now, David Miliband, or Ed Miliband, I should say, posted that. It's not been racist, but actually that made the news as well. Rupert Murdoch. Maybe Brits have too many holidays for a broke country. Now, you know, you could argue that maybe his reputation among the general populace isn't that high anyway. But what about this? A guy called Lee Van Bryan, you may or may not have heard of him, but free this week for a quick gossip or prep before I go and destroy America. He's a Brit. He meant they're going to party like mad. The US immigration authorities didn't think so. He was denied entry. He was sent home. Where is the Lulz now? LulzSec I mentioned. It's a hacking group. Luis Caron's worked for Panda Security. He's a very well-respected security researcher in our industry. When a bunch of LulzSec arrests were made a couple of weeks ago, 3 weeks ago maybe, he published a blog on their site, and the title of it is "Where is the Lulz now?" Anyone know what happened next?
You got hacked.
Panda got hacked. So it's just really a question of, you know, these are examples. Maybe you think, well, you're not in a situation where you're blogging on behalf of a company and reputation is at stake, but transfer it to what are you posting in terms of pictures or all of this stuff. I'll give you another example which didn't make the list, and that is a guy posted something on his Facebook wall. It was a morning after the night before picture, when he was a bit worse for wear, along with a comment to his mates that he was going to pull a sickie. He got the sack because his boss read it. I heard about it. I really just want to make the point of the Ronald Reagan thing. For those too young, he was US president for 8 years in the 80s. But it's not just online social media where people can actually do daft things. The background to this is that he was getting ready to do a national radio broadcast. He thought he was off air. He thought he was doing a test, a sound check, and that was all. He was live. to 250 million Americans potentially. And what he said is, I'd like to announce to you all that I've just ratified some legislation that will outlaw Russia forever. We begin bombing in 5 minutes. Well, the Russians listen to radios as well, so really outrageous thing for a US president to say. That's the days before the internet was widely used by anyone other than the military and academia. But it's not just Twitter, it's not just Facebook. It really goes for anything, really. If you want to check these out, when you get the slides, you can. These are just some general pointers as to what's sensible and what's not when you're on Twitter. Some food for